about a somewhat exotic topic, global air pollution, but making the link also with human health. I think this is something that could be of interest also for IGAC and CACGP. And I would in particular like to acknowledge a collaboration with John Evans of the Harvard School of Public Health. And we've become friends and learning a lot from each other. And you should realize that indoor air pollution and outdoor air pollution together cause about 7 million deaths per year, about half of them outdoors. So global pollution kills people. And we tackled this problem by making use of a model. And this is the EMAC model. E stands for the ECOM. This is the general circulation model developed at the Max Planck Institute for Meteorology in Hamburg. And we put chemistry in it. And these are sort of images that you would typically see also from these models. We have black carbon. Please note the scale changes here. Black carbon, particulate organic matter, dust, and sea salt. Of course, you expect the dust to be high over the Sahara and other deserts, the sea salt over the ocean. And this integrates into what we need for these assessments is PM2.5. Here we have sulfate and nitrate. Again, scale change with water. Most of the aerosol is water actually in the atmosphere. And this very much depends, by the way, on the chemical composition. So chemistry does matter for aerosol. So we need PM2.5 and ozone, and we calculate that with this model. And then we link that to functions a little bit like, you know, calculating radiative forcing. You take formulas that are being developed in other disciplines and you apply them to the data that you're generating, either from measurements or models. So we have mortality here. And mortality is calculating by multiplying the baseline mortality rates for a given population due to different diseases. And these diseases are ischemic heart disease, so that causes heart attacks, cerebrovascular disease, that causes stroke, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, lung cancer, and acute lower respiratory illness. And this last one, we call it ELRI, is mostly relevant for infants, especially the ones that are in areas where malnutrition is an issue. And the other ones are more important for people of advanced age. So we have a function here called RR. So these different data sets, population, for example, from the population division of UNDP. And then this RR is now being calculated based on a new function. It's given here, it's the second line, the second function here. And this has been revised because in some areas of the world the air pollution is so high that the ones that were used previously, they were based on studies in the United States and Europe, were no longer representative for the very high air pollution that we find nowadays in parts of Asia, for example. So this is a revised function, and it actually uses parameters. You see A, B here, and P. These are being derived from epidemiological studies. Then we have a change in annual mean concentration of pollutant. So pollutant in this case being PM2.5 or ozone. And the threshold, this is a bit of a discussion point. There is a threshold X naught here given, and this threshold is assumed to be the level at which no additional mortality occurs due to air pollution. And it's not sure actually that particulates have a threshold. So even at very low levels there might be health effects. But nevertheless, this is the reason why in some of the results later you will see that in some parts of the world we have zero mortality due to air pollution, that the reason is that the air pollution levels are below these thresholds. Then, it's mainly using a model. It's only a model, so you need to compare model output with data. And that's been done here. Now, I would like to emphasize is that these epidemiological functions, they use annual mean concentrations. And I think the reason being is that it's a little bit like with UV radiation. You have an integral over exposure. So if you live in a city, of course, the air pollution is very heterogeneous. You have small-scale variability. But this is not all that important. It's the integral of the exposure that people are being subjected to. And so what we see to the left here is an enormous cloud where we compare the output of this model with AeroNet observed aerosol optical depth. So these are all individual stations being compared with all closest data points in the model, and you get this enormous cloud. But nevertheless, you see that the root mean square error is relatively okay. And if you start averaging, like taking monthly means, you see that the root mean square error is going down, and the correlation is actually going up. And for the annual means to the right, we have a fairly good correlation and a small root mean square error, and we have almost no bias, and that's important, no bias. And if we do the same with MODIS, then we get a similar picture. And actually, this cloud looks more condensed, the reason being that we had to extend the scale to fit it on the same type of plot. So even if you correlate MODIS with AeroNet or observed optical depth, you get a very similar picture, a very similar root mean square error and very similar correlations. And this is mostly due, and Gibra Servas asking questions about this yesterday, it's a chaotic system and it's not possible. You know, there are very many small scale variability that of course you cannot capture with such a model. So this is the reason. But like I said, we're using the annual means, and I think for both data sets, MODIS and even our model, we're doing pretty okay. So the mortality attributable to air pollution in the year 2010 that we calculate with these functions and these data is 3.39 million per year. And this very well compares with an estimate that is done by the Global Burden of Disease. So this is sort of the IPCC for disease assessment. And they actually they use the same functions, these RR, these relative risk functions, but different data sets, mostly based on satellite data and to some extent also on model data. But you can see the numbers are quite consistent. For ozone, we have about 140,000 people per year, and the global burden of disease comes with 160,000, so that's also pretty close. And in total, we have about 3.5 million people per year that lose their life because of air pollution. And this is the statistical range given between 3 and 4 million per year. This is a little bit deceptive because there are uncertainties that cannot be captured by the statistical uncertainty alone, but I'm going to discuss this in a little bit more detail later. So we have 1.44 million because of cerebrovascular disease, stroke, heart attacks, 1 million per year, COPD, 0.6 million per year, lung cancer, 200,000. And acute lower respiratory illness for infants, 280,000 per year. Then if you take the global population in 2010, this was 6.8 billion, then we have a per capita mortality of about 5 people per 10,000 per year. So 5 people per 10,000 on this earth per year die because of air pollution. You see here listed again, stroke 2 per 10,000, ischemic heart disease comes second, COPD. You might have expected lung diseases to be more important, but actually strokes is the number one. And this is the sort of image that you get when you compare of when you also fold in the population data, so that explains the high resolution that you see here. But you can very clearly see the cities. I mean, let's go to the United States. In the west here, Mark, I think this is Atlanta. So you can clearly see the cities. Of course, urban air pollution is an important, I'm going to discuss this in more detail later as well. In Europe, of course, the Central Europe, also Western Europe, my home country, the Netherlands, is pretty polluted. Also, unfortunately, the area where I'm living now. So, yeah. But of course, which is not going to be a surprise to you, we find the highest mortality related to air pollution in the Indo-Gangetic Plain, where air pollution can be very high, and also in eastern China, southeastern China. The world champion here is the Pearl River area here. And also, you see the big cities in Japan and in Korea, for example. So they stick out. If you put this on a global perspective, you would get this image. This is, again, for 2010. This is now in units of individuals per square of 100 times 100 kilometers, which is about the grid square of our model. And now you can see in perspective that most of the mortality related to air pollution is taking place in South Asia and in East Asia, also Java, Indonesia, but also some areas in Africa. This is related to dust and biomass burning, but I'm going to allude on that later. If you do a business as usual scenario, now this is not a prediction, this is a business as usual scenario, then you would see this is the growth. So this is in addition to this one. This is in addition between 2010 and 2050 based on a business as usual scenario. So we have growth here, in particular in India. So if business as usual is not being averted and emissions are being controlled, then India is in really bad shape in future. Actually, you can see already in India, in some of the cities, that the air pollution level is very high, and that, of course, associated mortality is very high. If you look into the future for the year 2010, 2025, these are the populations. So we had 6.8 in 2010, nearly 8 in 2025, and a little bit more than 9 billion people on this globe being predicted by people that know about demography. And here are the different diseases. We see particularly strong increases in, again, stroke. So a very large number, and here are the integrals, so 3.5 million in 2010, almost 5.1 million per year in the year 2025, and more than 7 million per year in the year 2050. So there's a really great urgency to reduce air pollution to avoid these numbers to become reality. If you look at the top 20 countries again in 2010, then the number one is China, with 1.5 million per year. The number two is India, with more than 700,000 per year. Pakistan, Nigeria in Africa, Bangladesh. You see a lot of countries in Asia, actually. Indonesia, Vietnam, and also some European countries, but they come a little bit lower. But Russia is high on the list, Ukraine. USA, of course, these are also the big countries. Of course, this is to some degree also related to population. And also in the Middle East, we find countries like Iran, and later on I'll show some numbers also for Egypt, Myanmar, Congo, mostly because of biomass burning in Japan. Now, since we are using a model, we can do sensitivity tests and look at the causes of this mortality. So what are the categories that cause mortality related to air pollution? And now I must say that in this PM2.5, there is an implicit assumption that the chemistry does not matter, because the mortality is related to PM2.5, not to the composition of the particles. So this is what's been done here, and I'm going to show a sensitivity study later on where we change this assumption. But here you see that that actually you see sort of a patchwork, that in different parts of the world we have mortality related to different sectors. So we have industry, traffic. This is a very important sector. This is residential and commercial energy use. These are what we would call small combustion sources. So this is biofuel use. For cooking and heating, small sources, also diesel generator, this sort of stuff. Then we have here biomass burning. This is forest and savanna fires and agricultural waste burning. Power generation. Agriculture is important. It's ammonia emissions. And these natural is mostly desert dust. Now, no surprise, desert dust we find in the dust belt. We have biomass burning in Africa and in South America. And in the United States, we find traffic being important, power generation. But quite remarkably, in the eastern United States and also in much of Europe, we see agriculture as the number one source of mortality related, in this case, to PM2.5. And this, of course, is we've been in discussion also with the reviewers that found this a rather difficult thing to believe. I can go into more detail, but I don't think I have the time, so please ask questions later on. And we see in Asia, where most of the mortality occurs, that residential energy use is the number one. Yeah, this is probably the sort of table where you would say your students, don't put such tables into your presentation. But of course, I'm not a student. But to alleviate this problem a little bit, we can cover it up. So this is the world. This is now in percentage in these different, so this is natural. The world number is 3.5 million per year, 20% due to natural, 6% due to industry, 4% due to road traffic, very low, lower than you probably would have expected. More than 40% relate to energy, residential energy use, 11% power generation, 6% biomass burning, and 12% agriculture. And if you look at China, for example, we see that residential energy use and also India are really very important. In China also, agriculture is important, 18%. And look at some other countries like the USA. The leading one is actually traffic, but it's 26%. It's probably lower than you would expect it. Then we have some others, again, industry, residential energy use, power generation is a big one in the US, biomass burning, but also agriculture. And if you look at Germany, Russ, this is 32,000. So this is pretty much consistent with the number that you just told me. In Germany, we have 27,000 per year, industry, traffic is about the same as the United States, but the number one is agriculture. And the reason being is that ammonia is needed to form nitrate particles, but also sulfate particles. So we shouldn't think that sulfate particles form when there's no ammonia around. Especially aqueous phase production of sulfate depends on alkalinity provided by ammonia. Nigeria here, we have more than 100,000 per year. Natural, almost 80%, so this is dust. And here we have Congo, most of it is actually related to biomass burning. So it's quite a patchwork, quite a heterogeneous picture of, so actually, I think chemistry matters, and this is where we come in, where we can help this community to diversify their database. This is a few slides on dust. So this is dust particles with an aerodynamic size smaller than, diameter smaller than 2.5 micrograms over the Sahara. Of course, not too many people live in the Sahara. So, but if you put this into a list again in the top 10 annual pre-mortality countries, we find Egypt, almost 100,000 per year, Nigeria, China also large, Pakistan, India, of course some countries in the Middle East. If you put this on a per capita level, you see Niger, so countries in Northern Africa actually on top. And this is no surprise living in the vicinity of the Sahara Desert. Now, I mentioned before the implicit assumption for PM2.5 is that all particles are equally toxic. So we get this picture. But actually, if you ask experts in the field, they would say that probably carbonaceous aerosols, carbonaceous particles are more toxic than other ones. And so in working with these people, this is where John Evans has been critical. I think that the consensus thinking in the community is that carbonaceous particles are probably a few times more toxic than inorganic and crustal components. So we did a sensitivity calculation and assumed now that carbonaceous compounds are 5 times more toxic than inorganic and crustal compounds. And now we see actually an enormous increase of residential energy use also in Europe. Traffic also increases a bit because traffic also contributes to organic aerosols, and of course biomass burning increases a lot. So I can switch back and forth so that you can get a feel of where things are changing. Of course the biomass burning is expanding like in Africa, but also the residential energy use. And in Europe we get a slightly different picture. So there we have now traffic, more important, and also residential energy use. Residential energy use in this picture is really the number one killer in the world. So it's important to understand the chemical composition of organic particulates and what they do to human health. Then we can look a bit at urban air pollution. Now, of course, with a global model, you have to be a bit cautious about what you can say about urban areas. But Let's first look at the total population and extrapolate to the future. So in 2010, we had 6.8 billion in the urban environment, of which 6.8 in total, of which 3.6 is 53% in urban areas. In 2025, this is projected to increase to 7.8 in total billion, of which 55% is in urban environment. And in 2050, this may be more than 9 billion, of which 57% will live in cities. Then if you look at the premature mortality that we calculate, is the urban fraction is 60%. So actually, there is a lot of mortality also in the non-urban environment. We should not forget that. And it's also not only in megacities, which I'll show in a minute. And in 2025, this is expected to change to 5.1 million per year, of which 63% is in the urban environment. And in 2050, again, based on a business as usual scenario, this could be 7.15 million per year, and the urban fraction rule is therefore about 65%. So the urban fraction is actually increasing, not only because the more people live in cities, but also because cities are expected to become more polluted under a business as usual scenario. Now here's a list of megacities and the number of deaths, and the color code said something about the WHO regions. So here we have, this is what's called the European domain. This is the Eastern Mediterranean domain, Africa, Southern Asia. This is the Western Pacific domain, where you see most, and these are the Americas. And the biggest one in Europe is actually Istanbul and Moscow. Then we have in Africa's Lagos in Nigeria. You see big ones with many thousands of people, 23,000 people per year dying in Delhi alone because of air pollution. And then the really big ones we find in China, for example, Beijing here, Shanghai. But as I mentioned earlier, the world record is being held by the Pearl River area, which of course is also the largest conurbation in the world. And but many people are exposed to air pollution there. And in Americas, it's actually Los Angeles. Now, how good is this? This is a bit difficult to evaluate because we don't have these numbers on the city level. So we try to get them, at least in one city. And this is a study that we just submitted to ACP on central Beijing, using PM2.5 data from the US Embassy, and which started in 2001. Aeronet measurements is a station there, and six ground stations that are being, they started later, but they're available. And actually, they give a very consistent picture of this area in central Beijing. So we think also that we can use the data that have been collected at the US Embassy, at least for central Beijing, to give also some trend estimate of since 2001. But of course, we're not talking about trends here. So premature mortality in this area has been calculated again with the same categories. And the main one is a cerebrovascular disease, so stroke. So you can see these are the numbers in thousands, so 2,800 per year. And you see there's a bit of a jump here after 2009. And this appears to be related to population statistics. So here we used all the local data that we could get, not only the local air pollution data, but also the local statistics on population. And here you see also quite a steep increase of lower respiratory disease, is mostly in children. It's quite a steep increase, even though the total population has changed, but apparently, actually, the number of children has increased quite steeply. If we look at this from the perspective of a per capita mortality, and let's first add them together. So here we have the total premature mortality. You see it's increasing, and there's a bit of a jump here in 2010 up to 2012. But here we have the per capita mortality, and you can see it actually came down a little bit here. So this simply means that according to the population statistics, there was a strong increase in 2010 in the number of people living in central Beijing, I mean, we're not in a position to question these data, but it seems a little bit artificial. But what's important is the following. Is here we see a steep increase per capita premature mortality, and then it's more or less constant, say around 18 or so. And the number that we get for central Beijing is 17.7 per 10,000 per person year. So nearly 18 people per 10,000 per year in central Beijing die because of air pollution. And what we get from the model, and we cannot resolve central Beijing, we get it for larger Beijing, is 14.5. So it's a little bit lower. But I would say that this is consistent. This is at least well within the statistical uncertainty. So this gives me the feeling that this method works, even though you, of course, have to accept a rather large uncertainty. So to conclude, I think it's very important to realize that air pollution causes mortality. Air pollution kills people. And I think there is a task for this community with global air quality in its name, or global air pollution in its name, to now also make links with people in public health research, and not only too much focusing on, for example, the climate community. So air pollution causes respiratory and cardiovascular diseases, there's no question about that. And it's leading to about 3.5 million premature deaths per year worldwide. And we find that about 75% takes place in Asia. And even if we look at the scenarios into the future, we see that this number is consistent. It stays about 75%. Again, it's business as usual. I mean, we are in a position to change our future. We don't have to make business as usual to become reality. So we have residential energy use is really the main one, and this is dominant because actually it is the prevalent term in China and Asia. So these are small combustion sources. Traffic is important. Actually, there was a paper last year, a Chinese group, publishing a paper that traffic is only a minor contributor to PM2.5 in Beijing. And the whole community fell over these people. They brought no arguments, but everybody said it can't be, it has to be traffic. Believe me, it's not traffic. Traffic is important for NOx locally. Actually, it locally reduces ozone, it doesn't increase ozone. And downwind, of course, it makes nitrate. But it can only make nitrate if there is ammonium. So we have to also look at other sources. I think traffic, especially the organic fraction from traffic, is certainly important. But some of the other sources are much more important. And I think if you really want to combat air pollution, we'll have to look at these small combustion sources. Even in a city like Paris, it's about 30% of the premature mortality in Paris is due to small combustion sources. So yeah, you're nodding. I think this is being confirmed by some of the recent data that have been collected there. Agriculture is really important because it creates particles, because the particle formation is dependent on ammonia being around. Then we have, of course, natural sources. Now you can ask the question, how toxic are these? But actually the natural particles, they combine, especially the small ones, which have a relatively large surface to volume ratio, they combine with air pollution. So the body mostly sees the outside of these particles, which can actually be the toxic stuff that is being produced by air pollution. And then, of course, we see from the business as usual scenario that we have probably even more than doubling in the coming decades. And I think there is a task for this community to make sure that this is not going to happen. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So we have time for some questions for our speaker. Can we have a mic on the aisle? Back here on the aisle. You see him?
Thank you, Jos. It was really interesting to hear you talking about all these numbers and the risks connected to air pollution. One comment, and one thing that you showed really, that is the how you estimate the relative risk, and you showed if we have a relative risk connected to PM2.5 or whatever it was compared to for carbonaceous particles. And I think there is the real key, and there is the real area where air atmosphere chemists and modelers could actually help the epidemiological community. Because right now, they don't know how to estimate the relative risk. They have the common relative risk for the whole particles, but what part of the particles are really the hazardous things? And there is, as you've mentioned, the soot particles, as they call it, is considered to have a higher risk. But how much higher risk? You just picked a number five times. And that is as good as any, I would say. But they need much better models, urban models, to connect to their health data to really come up with relative risks that you could attribute to different sources. And that's
where the line is,
I would say.
Because I see a lot of studies on urban models, and I think they miss a lot. Because a lot of the air pollution that you find in Paris or London, for example, is not locally produced. So you have to look at the larger area, and an urban, this is a typical problem in this community. They're working with urban models.
I don't realize that much
of the stuff comes from outside. But I completely agree with your remarks. Yeah.
Okay, another question right here.
Jos, thanks for the excellent talk. That was really, really interesting. And I also agree with the point about the urban models, that you need the sources from outside. That's what we saw in the Paris measurements. But also global models have their problems. And if you go back and think about this, question is about the slide that you showed with the individual cities in the WHO categorization. And there were a few things on there. I assume that's based on data from global model. And there were a few things on there that seemed a little strange. First off, Sao Paulo had a number of zero. And Mexico City was less than Los Angeles. Can you explain a little bit about that and what you're thinking about doing to improve that? Manila's also zero. I missed that before.
Yeah, but this, the reason being that the annual average concentration is below the threshold. But as I indicated in the introduction, is that these thresholds are being debated, actually. So in our paper, we also did some sensitivity tests. But you're also, I think it's a perfectly valid point, is that, you know, how good is a global model in resolving in Mexico City? I would say there is room for improvement here, absolutely, yeah.
Thanks.
So I'll take two more questions. Steve, back here in the corner. And is there one over here? Yes, right here in the middle will be the last question.
So the statistics you cite are certainly concerning, that range 3.5 million to 7 million in mortality. I'm wondering if there are other metrics that you can use to measure this, though. I mean, the simple incidence of respiratory disease must be much, much larger than the mortality rate, and I wonder if you've looked at that.
Yeah, what you do is you take the baseline mortality rate. So this is the number that WHO produces. You know, WHO communicates with the local governments on how many people die on respiratory disease. And then you use these epidemiological functions to estimate what fraction of the number of people that die from respiratory disease is related to air pollution. And that's where these epidemiological cohort studies come in. And there's a limitation there. Most of the work has been done in the United States. It's really enormous. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of people. But the question is, even if this is a very reliable or good statistics, how representative is that for Southern Asia, where apparently the composition of the particles is particularly different? Now, some new studies are coming in for China, and these numbers are actually quite consistent with the numbers in the United States. And also in Europe, we have different, or not very different, but somewhat different composition, and the numbers seem to be consistent. So there is large uncertainty. There is also uncertainty on the baseline mortalities. But of course, this is the same like tobacco smoking. You know, you have a number of people dying from lung cancer on tobacco smoking. People dying from lung cancer, and a certain fraction is related to tobacco smoking. And you use these types of studies to estimate the fraction. And this is how it works.
The last question.
All right, thank you very much for this wonderful talk. I was kind of wondering, your model really seems to predict much more bad news for Asia and specifically West Africa, looking at parts of Nigeria. I'm kind of wondering if that doesn't have to do anything to do with the high population sizes.
With the what?
High population numbers, because these places are overpopulated. So if you're doing a prediction, you're going to see much more death in these areas.
No, population is one of the important terms. So you combine population data with air pollution data. So like in the central Sahara, you have actually, this is the most polluted part of the world because you have so much dust. You have something like 500 micrograms annual average desert dust, PM2.5 alone. Of course, PM10 is even much higher. There's no people. But in cities like Lagos, there you have a lot of people who are also exposed to the air pollution from the Sahara. So it's a combination of population and air pollution.
And then one more part of that question is the emissions which are seen, like let's say in China and India, someone maybe can correct me, couldn't they be affecting the countries around so that we see spikes in the neighboring countries around this regions? Why is it only concentrated in India and the neighboring countries are totally okay?
Well, actually Bangladesh and Pakistan is pretty bad as well. You see cities like Dhaka and I mean, it's not only India. So I'm not trying to do India any harm, but the fact is that the Indo-Gangetic Plain is one of the most polluted areas in the world. And we actually know that from measurements as well. So this is, and actually this is also one of the most populated areas in the world. So this is what, and of course the population also causes the problem. So it's a related problem, but these things come together, yeah.
So
okay, thank you.
Let's thank our speaker one more time.